You're watching CBBC. It's time to get arty now with Smart.
Welcome to Smart.
The show that... a little bit out of focus.
Come on, you pair of softies, sharpen up.
Hey, Mark does the bad gags round here.
Yeah! What?
OK, as you've probably guessed, today we're looking at focus, and I've got a perfect example of exactly what I mean in this photograph that I've taken here. You can see in the foreground the railings are perfectly in focus. You can see every detail on them, but the entire background is all out of focus. It's very, very fuzzy, but you can still see sort of what's there. You can see the tree, there's a path, there's sort of green bits in the background, and I'm going to attempt to recreate this photograph on a picture here, using all of these lovely coloured pastels. I'm going to start, I think, with a nice dark green. And all I'm going to do is a suggestion of everything that's there. It doesn't have to be neat at all, but make sure I've got lots of pastel on. There's a bit of a fir tree there. And let's give it a nice brown bottom. And then I think I'll do a person sitting under the tree. Yellow hair. Might be me. And wearing blue. There we go. Now, what else shall I do? I think lots of nice flowers. So, again, you don't have to be neat at all, just so long as you make sure you get lots of colour onto the paper. Oh, that's lots of nice pink and yellow as well. Loads and loads of flowers there. Let's get a lighter green on the go now, as though there's a bit of grass in there. And a path. Let's go for that colour. Lovely. I think I'll just do another bit of hedge in another green, as though that's along there, and then the top, fill it out with sky. So make sure you fill up the entire space of your picture with colour. Now, the next stage, you know how some people hate the fingers going down a blackboard? That's what it feels like for me doing this, so bear with me. It makes me feel a bit funny. Here we go. I'm going to blend it all in like that, starting with the sky up there and then into the hedge. And then let's get this tree. Lovely. All the colours just mixing together now. The little person sitting there. The path. Take it right the way out to the corners. So you're blending all the way, and now a nice flowery area. OK, now I know what you're thinking. Thinking, Kirsten, that looks like an absolute tit, but bear with me, I'm just going to blow off all the excess. Like that. Now, that's the out-of-focus part. For the next bit, I'm using a really thick marker pen, and I'm going to draw on my railings in the front. So let's start here. Like that. Let's get a bit going down there. And there. You can see this is really thick, black, bold colour. Perfect. I think what I'll actually do is bring those a little bit of the way up, like that. All of the tops. A little bit of shape. Finish that one off up there. Just use the edge to do a nice little swirl. And then just as a final touch, just do some little lines in there. And there you see, in the foreground, the railings are perfectly in focus. And it's as though we're kind of peering through into a secret garden. We don't quite know what's there. It's a really good effect, isn't it? Why don't you give it a go? Why don't you soften up your art?
The Spanish artist Pablo Picasso could draw before he'd learned to walk. And his first word was pencil.
Right, here's a smart tip for you. This is a photograph that I've taken. Now, I'm quite happy with it, but I think I could improve it just by the way I mount it. Now, how do I do that, do you ask? Well, here's a piece of card, and I've cut a rectangle into it. And the trick is, by using masking tape, sticky side up on the top and bottom, I can then slide it underneath my card and select the composition that I want to frame. Now, there's too much pavement and railing in there, so I think I'm going to go for the top of the photograph, which has a nice perspective of the railing. And then you just apply some pressure where your masking tape is to fix your picture. I'm really happy with that, and there's a tidy way to mount your photos.
Time for a toon tip. Devices. Well, cartoon devices. What are they? Well, they're used instead of speech bubbles and they're often more effective. Let me show you. This chap's had a bright idea. How do we reinforce that? Well, we do a little light bulb. Just the top and, of course, a little cloud around it. Just to reinforce. He's had a corker of an idea. This guy here is pretty angry. But let's make him really angry by making him stare daggers. He looks really upset now. This chap here, he's in love. Oh, so what do? We give him some little love hearts, but some little clouds around them like this. And now we know that he's really daydreaming in love. Oh. This guy here, he's fast asleep. What do? Well, of course, we give him some Zeds, but we make those Zeds bigger and bigger and bigger because he's snoring really loudly. Why don't you have a go and see if you can make up your own cartoon devices? More tips next time.
If the word aquarium makes you think of an old Victorian building with just a few small tanks of fish, well, think again. This is an aquarium for the 21st century. I'm here in Hull, where they've combined the latest technologies with the ancient wonders of the ocean to form the deep. From the striking building by the River Humber, which looks rather like a glass-sided rocket bursting out of the ground,
to the massive fish tanks themselves and their amazing collection from all over the world. This building really is impressive, and it's an artist's paradise with so much inspiration. The colour and variety of species of fish in this tank is just amazing. Here at the top of the 10-metre tank, it's hard to believe it holds over 2.25 million litres of water. Now, you are incredibly close to the sharks in the tank. And to be quite honest with you, this is the closest that I will ever get to one of these sharks. We're now at the bottom of the tank, and not only is there several different species of shark, but there's also the golden trevally, which has got an awesome colour and it's going to be the subject of my painting. Now, I'm going to use aluminium foil, and I've just folded it a couple of times, like that. I'm just going to take a pencil and work straight into this basic kitchen foil. And it's like a kind of embossing technique. And your lines can be quite jagged, because then that gives you kind of like this technique that you see actually on a fish, quite scaly, which is what the aluminium gives you anyway as quality. If you push too hard with your pencil and you rip the foil, don't panic, because you're going to paint over it and you're not going to notice it because there's two layers of foil, so keep going with it. Now, I'm drawing these fish moving down the tank, so there'll be darker tones here, so just shade that in with your pencil, and lighter at the top end of the tank, because you've got that light just bursting in through the water, just off the top there. Right, I'm happy with that outline, so now I'm going to go straight to paint. Now, I'm taking my colours, and I'm just applying them straight onto the aluminium surface, which is quite slippery, so the paint is just sliding around on there quite easily. Right, I've got lots of colour on there, but I want to remove some of that, so I've just got some kitchen roll here, and I'm just going to drag off these colours off the aluminium foil, so I've got some of that silver coming through my paint. Sharks are just having lunch behind me, but I'm not going to let that distract me. The fact that the kitchen roll is removing the paint is allowing the foil to show through and giving the picture a real watery effect, which is what I want to achieve. Right, let's get a smaller brush and go for some detail now actually on these fish. Two more like that and I'm laughing. Yes, I'm really happy with that. I think it looks really tidy. The foil gives it a three-dimensional quality and the fish practically look like they're swimming across it. I think the painting's gone swimmingly.
The largest art gallery is in Russia. You would have to walk 15 miles to see all the 322 galleries.
Whilst they set up for the finale, I've got time to show you a way of making your own postcards. All you need is a rectangle of white card and then stick on a coloured piece of paper and just round those edges off. Then you're ready to start adding your design. What I've got is double-sided tape onto all my shapes that I've cut out, and I've edged them all in black marker so that they all stand out. And I'm using lots of bright colours. Now, that's a vase, and then I've got the window up there and lots of nice, brightly coloured flowers. And the centres of my flowers are just stickers that I've stuck on in different colours. They work very effectively. There we go, a nice vase of flowers. And the final touch I'm just going to add with my pen, add all the stalks, there we go, and a few leaves as well, I think. And then if you edge that, you're ready to put your message on the back. There we go, wish you were here. Leaving space for the address, of course, on the other side. And then you can pop that in the post and send it to your friends, and you can do all manner of designs. What about this incredible space picture I've done there? Or this desert island scene? Why don't you give it a go? Hey, Mark, what do you think of my mail art?
Darling, I am mail art.
Gustave Caillebotte was a wealthy Parisian who befriended a group of painters known as the Impressionists. They had radical ideas about the use of colour and light in their paintings, but the established art world initially treated them with suspicion. Caillebotte supported his struggling friends by financing their exhibitions and buying their artwork. Without him, we might never have heard of such artists as Monet and Renoir. However, Caillebotte himself was a highly skilled painter. His use of perspective in Paris Street Rainy Day gives the painting a great sense of depth. And the reflected light on the cobbled streets and umbrellas gives this painting an atmosphere worthy of the great Impressionists he supported.
Now, here's a novel way of capturing animals with water and ink, and you wouldn't believe how easy it is to achieve. First of all, I've started off by drawing a very basic shape of a line. I'm going to bring it to life by adding coloured ink. Now, I've got my selection of colours here, but first of all, I'm going to give it a wash of water with a brush, and that's all I'm using the brush for. So let's just give it a little bit of a wash at the top of the body here, like so. And now I'm just literally going to squeeze on a colour. First of all, I'm going for this lovely daffodil yellow. And watch this, I'm just going to drop it on and let the colour do all the work. Look at the way it just literally bleeds into all the water, it's lovely. Leave it at that. I think I'll put a little bit more water around here. Now, what I want to do is try and have a little bit of separation, because I'm going to put another colour down for the lion's mane. So put that down there like that, probably a little bit more. And I think this time I'll go for the Indian yellow. It's a slightly darker colour. Let me just drop it in there. Wow, wonderful. Look at the way that spreads out all the way down here. That's lovely. Remember, less is more, as I always say. I think I'll put another colour for the head now. I'll do... Actually, that mane's looking really nice. Nice and textured. For the top of the head here. Again, try and leave a little bit of a gap. And I'll go back to the daffodil yellow again. Here we go. Drop it in. Bosh, look at that. Hey, that's smashing. Wonderful, right? And I think now I'll go underneath the body and have a bit of shadow, so I'll use the darker yellow again. Here we go, ready? Oh, that's lovely. And the trick about this, as you see, the two colours will merge in together, so you get natural shading and toning, which is really nice. Now, what I haven't done here is done his legs. Let me put that back in there, otherwise I get into all sorts of trouble. So let's put a bit of water down on the front here for his back leg and front leg. Let's get the Indian yellow in there. Just drag it down. I can cheat that a little bit. Lovely. And the darker yellow. Oh, water first. Colour second, that's right. Just get that a little bit down there. Because those legs are in shadow, so I'm using a slightly darker tone. Look at that, lovely. I think what I will do is actually use this pipette just to drag out a little bit of texture on the lion's mane there to give it a bit of a fur sort of feel to it. Just drag that down like that. That's nice. Lovely. Now, I will use the brush only for one instance, and that's just to drag out the tail, like this. A bit of dark yellow just for the tip. Wonderful. Now, what we need to do now is to give it something to stand on, so a nice bed of grass. So I think what I'll do for that, again, a little bit of wash of water. Try not to mix it into the other colours, so you create little sort of pools, if you like. Lovely, and a bit of green this time. Grass green. Drop it in. Oh, look at that. Isn't that smashing? Look. Whee, all the way down there. Lovely. Oh, that's lovely. Now, I think what I'll do is, my little trick, I'll get a straw, a drinking straw, and literally just blow the paint upwards, like this.
Hang on. Go on. Oi! Oh, got his stomach. Never mind, it's long grass. You can forgive me for that. Well, that's nice. I think what I will do now is just get a little bit of tissue and just take that bit of grass out of his tummy. Here we go. Here we go. Look, problem solved. Wonderful. Look at that. Well, I'm really happy with my abstract inky line. Just to finish it off, I'll give it a nice jungly frame. Perfect.
X-rays have shown that there are three different versions of Mona Lisa underneath the top coat of paint.
Well, we'll have more art to focus your mind next time. So remember,
if you're glued to art,
then stick with smart.
Bye. Bye.
You can post your gallery pictures to smart. PO Box 5053, London W12 6AW. And if you'd like a fact sheet, they're available on the CBBC website.
One more thing to show you before we go. A really simple way to glam up your presents. I've started off with just some brown parcel paper, and I'm going to take some raffia, which you can get in any craft shop, but you don't have to use raffia, you can use string. Just going to tie that round there. Put a double knot at the top. Doesn't matter if you've got an excess left over. Now I'm going to use a skeleton leaf, okay, again, that you can purchase in any craft shop, but you don't have to use a skeleton leaf, you can use just normal leaves. Now we're going to spice up our wrapping paper using a cinnamon stick. Just pop that through there. And there you have it, a really chic present. Why don't you give it a go?